June 20th, 1808, is the birthday of Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, a very important figure in 19th century Judaism. He articulated a strategy for survival with the modern world that has had its impact lasting certainly to the present day with no sign of slowing down. Specifically, during the beginning of the 19th century, there was a crisis going on, particularly in German Jewry. Some of the ideas that had first been circulated by Rabbi Moses Mendelssohn in the Haskalah movement had reached their fruition, and there were really three main movements that had been created in response to the ideas of the Haskalah. That is the burgeoning idea of engaging in modernity in a more significant fashion, although not necessarily keeping to the traditional norms of Judaism. Abraham Geiger was the figurehead of the liberal movement, known today as the Reform movement, that was rapidly garnering a lot of support among the rank and file of the Jewish population, and were wholesale abandoning many traditional observances and reverting to norms of worship that were more typical of German Protestants, for example. And the goal was, through the Reform movement, to demonstrate that Jews were in fact worthy of political emancipation so long as they had adapted their modalities of worship to a sensibility that would make sense in the 19th century. Zacharias Frankel, in a very similar vein, broke off from the Reform movement to create the historical positivist movement, which is known today as the conservative movement, which basically followed the same ideology as Reform originally, but insisted that their pace of change was far too rapid for Jews of that century. And they argued for a much more measured approach to the changes that were being wrought quite wholesale in Jewish practice at the time. And on the other side of the spectrum, more in the northern Hungarian region of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, the Chatam Sofer, very important rabbi, articulated a total rejection of modernity and formed the nucleus of what would later become the Haredi philosophy, or ideology perhaps is a better term, which strives to reject outright any encounter with modernity, or as insofar as that is possible. So you had like these three movements, or really two and a half movements, that were attempting to deal with modernity. What of the more traditional Orthodox in Central Europe? That's where Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch found a niche in the intellectual currents of that day. He argued that Jews should neither abandon traditional practice, nor should they reject modernity, and in fact they should find a kind of a middle path to deal with the challenges of the 19th century and beyond. And he put this in two main strategies. The first strategy was what we might call accommodation. That is, he realized that modernity was simply not going away, and more significantly, Jews were voting with their minds and with their feet, and were attending a lot of these non-traditional synagogues, attending universities, and when necessary, they were simply abandoning Judaism and converting in order to gain, you know, traction in secular professions and education. So he felt that on the one hand, Judaism did have to adapt to modernity, only in those areas which were not really mandated by the Torah or by rabbinic standards. He reached out, for example, to Jews in Germany by writing in German and in a very literate, high-quality German. Most significantly was his work, The 19 Letters, which has been translated in English. It's a very important book, in which he discusses in the form of a dialogue between a younger man and an older man the virtues of Judaism. He then followed that up with an extremely influential and really powerful book, a book of philosophy called Chorev, which is a really audacious restatement of the 14th century Sefer Achinuch, the Book of Education, in which he outlined something which many of the enumerators of the commandments does not do, he indicates the reasons for the commandments, as opposed to the bulk of the later medieval commentators on the Jewish tradition, who, you know, restricted themselves to interpreting how to perform the commandments. Rav Hirsch wrote why one should perform the commandments, which was really in thinking with a lot of the Jews of the 19th century who were searching for some kind of, reason for retaining the ancestral faith. We see this idea continuing on in books like, for example, my good friend Rabbi Becher's Gateway to Judaism, which follows in this tradition of the Sefer HaChinuch and Chorev, although in a 20th century format. That's a plug for my friend's book. I highly recommend it. The other strategy was more controversial. So in the first strategy, he's essentially dealing with ways of accommodating modernity. The second was much more controversial. It was known as the Austritt, or the secession. And that is that when Rabbi Hirsch realized that ultimately it would be impossible to maintain the integrity of traditional worship in a single kahila or a single community, he petitioned successfully the Prussian authorities to allow him to create a second Jewish community. Now, looking at this from the 21st century perspective of America, where of course we have, sometimes hundreds of synagogue communities in a given location, this may not seem strange at all. To a certain degree, that is evidence of the efficacy. Is that a real word? The efficacy. Yeah, that's a better word. The efficacy of Rav Samson Raphael Hirsch's strategy, in that we have adopted this strategy. That is, we have separated in order to maintain the diversity of our beliefs in an environment which is conducive to the practice at a particular halachic standard. But in the 19th century, this was totally unheard of. This was something dramatic and met with challenges both from without the Orthodox community and from within the Orthodox community, arguing that perhaps what Rav Hirsch had done was a transgression of the rabbinical command of Hillel, Al tifrosh min hatzibur, do not separate from the community. Nevertheless, Rav Hirsch's thinking was that it would be impossible to maintain the observance of Shabbat, of Kashrut, of the laws of family purity, and so on, in an environment where the Reform movement had gained so much popularity. And so therefore he said, we need to set up a separate Jewish community, completely separate. After receiving permission to do so, and in fact creating that community, this has been a trend that has been followed by Orthodox Jews ever since. And in fact, it was under Rabbi Hirsch that the term Orthodox itself gained currency. This was a fairly new term from the 19th century. His legacy is extremely complex, and we see it in so many different ways. We see it, for example, in the institution known as Yeshiva University, which also attempts to create an accommodation with modernity to not necessarily blend traditional Judaism and modernity, but nevertheless to find a modus vivendi that does certainly precludes rejection of modernity. We see it in the lifestyles of Jews in America today, many of whom are able to balance, like Senator Lieberman, tremendously advanced careers in the overall culture. He, of course, was a contender for the vice presidential position of the United States of America. It's a huge position. While at the same time maintaining traditional observances commensurate with Orthodox lifestyles. This is very much a Hirschian kind of strategy. So June 20th is his birthday. We celebrate his legacy several hundred years later, and we're certain to continue to see the impact of his thought in coming centuries.